welcome to another show, Coffee with Karim. Guess what? Karim's having coffee today. Woohoo! Love this stuff. I like it strong, sweet, and creamy myself. Yeah, I guess I've become a little snobby when it comes to my coffee. It's like when I go to someone's house, I'm like, hey, do you have any coffee? They're like, yeah, sure. And they like pull out some instant coffee. I'm like, no thanks. I'd rather not have any. But yeah, I like to purchase my beans, fair trade, light or medium roast. I grind them every morning and pull out my French press and have a good time. Really good. I wanted to share a couple of facts about coffee. Also known as the wine of Islam. How did it get that name? Well, we're going to learn that today. But a few fun facts for our listeners out there. Coffee is the second largest commodity in the world after oil. As you know, oil is a big deal. I mean, we've had Operation Freedom wars in the past. Who knows? Maybe one day we'll have Operation Caffeine. Bring caffeine to, you know, countries that don't like our coffee drinking. That wouldn't be a bad thing. Coffee is also considered a fruit, which I love because now when my wife tells me you're not eating enough fruit, I'm going to say, hey, I have a smoothie of fruit every morning. It's called coffee. Guess who's the leading consumer of coffee? Dun-dun-dun-dun. USA, baby. At approximately 146 billion cups of coffee drunk every year. And approximately 80% of all adults in the US drink coffee, according to the Food and Drug Administration. Which is really interesting fact because, you know, our current political environment, there's a lot of negative association with the Muslim world. And, you know, next time you go to Dunkin' Donuts and Starbucks and what have you, remember that that cup of magical elixir came to you because of your Muslim friends out there. So hopefully we can all have a cup of coffee together and talk things out a bit more. I mean, that would be great. So let's talk a bit more about the history of coffee and why is it called the wine of Islam? Well, first of all, the word for coffee in Arabic is qahwa. And qahwa was actually a term that described wine in Arabic as well. So it kind of got passed on to this new elixir that was discovered. And I'm sure many Muslims were like, finally, we've got something we can drink now too. And when coffee spread to other non-speaking Arabic lands, such as, you know, Turkey, they called it kahva with a V. And this kahva eventually evolved into coffee or cafe. So that's where we get those two words from, also from the Arabic language originally. So where does coffee actually come from? Well, many sources suggest that it was first, it originated in Ethiopia, Eastern Africa, and brought over to southern Arabia by Yemeni traders. And in Yemen, it was, you know, harvested and became very popular among social and spiritual circles, specifically Sufi tariqas. And some sources say that, you know, the Shadili tariqa is one that integrated this into their social and spiritual practices. So, for instance, drinking coffee, they would do it in kind of a ceremonial fashion where you would brew it and then kind of pass a bowl around and everyone would take a sip and keep drinking. And then they would go into spiritual mantras and chanting. They would read Quran or stay up late to pray, tahajjud, etc. And so it was an integral part of social and spiritual life in Southern Arabia. And as it kind of moved north, when it was first received in Mecca, it was actually banned in 1511 because the leaders there believed that it caused radical thinking. This was also the case when coffee entered places like Cairo and other parts of the Muslim world. And it wasn't until the mid-1600s that an Ottoman mufti or legal scholar came out and just said, okay, we're going to halalify this. It's all good. It doesn't intoxicate. So, you know, drink up and let's enjoy this. And by that point, you had, of course, many aspects of Muslim culture developing what we would call the first cafes, where people would come together, socialize, exchange intellectual ideas, and of course, converse in all kinds of different matters. By the mid to late 1600s, it starts to enter into Europe. And when it first gets to places like Italy, it was actually considered to be satanic, so it was also banned there. However, Pope Clement VII loved coffee so much that he lifted the ban and had coffee baptized, so to speak, and that was approximately around 1600 as well. And what's funny is even in Sweden, up until 1746, the Swedish government made it illegal to even have coffee paraphernalia, including cups and dishes. So it's pretty funny how people in general, when we're introduced to something new, we don't quite understand it. We tend to have this position to just say no, because if it's unfamiliar, we can be afraid of it. And obviously, if we don't understand something, we're not sure of the total consequences. But thankfully, coffee took a strong hold in many parts of the world. And until today, it's a very popular drink. And, you know, as an American and here in the United States, as we learned, it's probably the largest consumed drink. Now, what's interesting about coffee is when the way they used to brew it in Yemen was very different than how you would have it today in Starbucks or wherever else you go. So, as you know, coffee is it's like a greenish-reddish bean. And what the early Muslims and Arabs used to do was they would just boil this bean and mix it with some spices, usually things like cardamom. And you can still find this type of coffee around the Muslim world. You know, they call it Arabian coffee. And it almost looks like a green tea. And that stuff is like rocket fuel, man. It's so strong and will keep you buzzed for like 8 to 12 hours, if not longer. And this is, you know, contrary to what many of us think, a dark roast of coffee is not actually stronger or more potent. And that's one of the things I learned when I went to a coffee farm in Hawaii. Hawaii, by the way, is the only place in the United States that grows coffee. So I went to a farm there. The tour guide was teaching us that the more you roast coffee, the more you kill the caffeine. So it's like when you basically cook it down. So basically, if you want coffee that has a good caffeine punch, you want to go with light roasts and maybe some mediums too, which is usually what I do. I get a nice light or medium roast and I brew it nice and strong. And that's just like, woo, gives you a nice buzz. The concept of roasting coffee, historically, it's suggested that maybe the Persians were the first to introduce this concept. But I definitely got to give it to the Italians, man. I mean, they just took it to that next level with, you know, milk and cream and lattes and whatnot. And that's my sharing on coffee. I felt like I had to do it. I mean, the show's called Coffee with Karim, so I needed to give it a little love. But let's move on to our next topic for today, which is still connected to coffee, by the way. So earlier I was mentioning that, you know, coffee was harnessed by certain Muslim spiritual groups in Southern Arabia, also known as Sufi tariqas, and which means paths of the inner sciences of Islam. And I think that, you know, in the West, we often associate Sufism with like Rumi, you know, this wonderful poet of Persian descent. And sometimes Sufism is kind of seen as its own religion that has nothing to do with Islam, or something even more New Agey that isn't, you know, connected to the tradition, which I think is one of the reasons why some Muslims themselves are like, oh, that's whack, you know, that's not really our religion. But from my research and experience, I think one way to understand Sufism is it's the heart of Islam. In other words, it's the teachings that help the practitioner psycho-spiritually evolve and experience these notions of transcendence and transformation. Oftentimes in a lot of, you know, certain Islamic institutions or Muslim organizations, I think there's a lot of emphasis on exoteric understanding or practices. In other words, the outside stuff, you know, the rituals, the doctrine, the rules, the regulations, here's what you do, here's what you don't do, here's what you believe in, what you don't believe in. But then you're just kind of left with that, and you just kind of memorize all these things, and you do all these things. But I find that in my work, especially with, you know, Muslims that grew up in the West and elsewhere, there's this like disconnect from a sense of almost like personalizing your relationship with the divine. And I really think that has to do with a lack of healthy Sufism. And Sufism comes from most likely the Arabic word tasawwuf. So the purpose is purification and beautification of the self, or the ego. And these spiritual sciences or inner sciences is another way to understand it in the contemporary terms. It's basically Islamic psychology. So think about it like this. If Islam is a path to God, i.e. it's a deen, right, that you fulfill to establish that relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow the guidance and the manual that He sent, Islamic psychology is your individual journey on that path to God. So we know that the pinnacle of consciousness, according to the Islamic tradition, is to be a muhsin, one who is beautified in their character, in their presence, and of course in their relationship to the divine. And how do you have a beautiful relationship with someone? Well, you have to love them, obviously. If you don't love somebody, it's going to be very hard to treat them well and with excellence and to actually care. So one of the things that Tasawwuf tries to harness is real practical love of God. And this is something that is attainable according to the Quran. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna Allaha yuhibbul muhsinin," chapter 2, verse 195. Allah loves those who have excellence and beauty in their character. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentions purification of the self in Surah Ash-Shams, chapter 91, verse 7. وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. The translation is, "And by the soul and he who proportioned it and inspired it with the discernment of what is wicked or evil and what is good and righteous, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. He has succeeded who purifies it." In other words, this selfhood or this ego. "And he who has failed to purify it instills within it corruption or darkness." So the concept of purifying the self and having healthy psychology is all over the Quran. Those are just a few examples, but it's filled with it. And like I said, bringing it back to this idea of love of God and adoring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is one of the meanings of to be Abdullah. We always say we're here to worship God. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And part of the meaning of abada is to serve and adore and love God. Because think about it. When I say something like, "Hey man, you worship Michael Jordan." When someone says that, you know that I don't literally mean the person like gets down and prostrates and worships Michael Jordan. But what it means is they're obsessed with the guy. They love his game. They know his stats. They have all his jerseys and his t-shirts and his sneakers. And everything's Michael Jordan. It's like, man, you worship the guy, right? So the concept here is if you love and adore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's what's on your mind the most. That's what you're striving towards the most. That is what tasawwuf is really trying to do. And you can't love someone unless you really feel intimately connected or bonded to that person. Similarly, you can't really love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if all you do is practice external rituals and have creed and dogma memorized, but it doesn't really penetrate your heart and your consciousness. You don't really perceive the world in that way. And that's why you meet a lot of insincere people who on the outside look religious, but they're not very sincere. They believe in all this stuff, or they claim they believe in all these things, like, yeah, be honest, be good to your family, but they're constantly, you know, using the religion to manipulate people and situations for their own agenda, whether it's within husband and wife, or, you know, a mother-in-law and her daughter-in-law and the son, and, you know, there's all kinds of ways this plays out. And it's like, well, do we really believe that God sees and hears everything and we're going to be accountable? Because if we did, how could you treat somebody like that? How could you talk like that? How could you say you didn't do something when you really did do something? You know, this is a lack of sincerity. But these are just kind of some examples of trying to, you know, enlighten everybody out there that illumination and connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also has to come through experience and has to come through taking it to that next step to cultivate your internal world. Or else, what's the point of doing all these rituals? What's the point of having all these nice books? You know, you read all these nice books on fiqh and whatnot. One of my teachers, he put it in a beautiful way. He said, learning, you know, tasawwuf is like cultivating a beautiful garden with flowers and a nice landscape and all this stuff, nurturing the grass. And Sharia, or the external practices, is like building a fence to protect your garden. And if you don't have a garden, what's the point of having these tall walls and these fences without anything to actually protect on the inside? And the opposite is also true. What's the point of cultivating all this inner beautification if you have no Sharia to protect it and to preserve it? So you have to have the inside and the outside working cohesively and in harmony, or else you're missing a big part of the picture. You have to first accept a basic premise, which is that the divine is perfect and you're not. You're a human being, therefore you're always going to have folly and limits and growth areas. And if you can accept that there's always room to grow, then it means there is always purification to be had. There's always this internal struggle that you must be embarking on. There's never a point of arrival where you know, khalas, I graduated from Islamic, you know, spirituality and religion, now I can just kind of sit back and wait to enter Jannah, right? No, I mean, because if I want to make something better, or more excellent, or more beautiful, I have to first acknowledge the ugliness, or the limits, or the incompetence that exists in that thing or that person, or else what is the point, right? So this is also about deeply reflecting and being humble, and this comes through the gate of sincerity, all right? And sincerity is, in my opinion, it's the crown of all character traits. Because without it, you can't really get far in life if you're not even honest with yourself and honest with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's kind of the beauty of having this type of divine relationship, because you can play games with your husband, with your wife, with your kids, with your parents, with people. You can put on a nice public face and put on a show, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows exactly who you are, and He sees right through you. Hence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, chapter 50, verse 16, He created the human being and He knows exactly what we whisper to ourselves. He's closer to you than your jugular vein. So to bring this all together, if tasawwuf is the heart of Islam and love is rooted in the heart, then tasawwuf is also about loving God and systematizing the pathway or the art and science of how do I really personalize my relationship to the divine? Because it's easy to say you should love God more than anything else. You should have ihsan in your actions. You should have taqwa and so on and so forth. But if there's no system or science to that, then how exactly are you going to embody those principles realistically? And that's what tasawwuf is all about. It's about offering that path with clear direction, mentoring, and exercises, which helps purify the heart and purify the mind so that you can see more clearly. And you can't have vision if your sight is blind or blurred or foggy because of the ugliness or state of your own soul. And I think that's, you know, a good intro for now. And certainly we will come back to some of these themes in future shows. But to kind of end with today, I wanted to offer a historical frame of how to understand tasawwuf in Islamic civilization. So if you think about the Prophet Muhammad SallAllahu Alaihi Wasallam and the companions, the way they lived religion was as organized spirituality. And what I mean by that is, I mean, the first half of the Prophet's mission, there wasn't a lot of emphasis on rituals and laws. That didn't come until the Medini period, so about 12 years in. And the first half of the mission was all about purifying character, purifying the mind of unhealthy beliefs, improper constructs about people, ourselves, reality, and of course God, right? So this is why a lot of the early revelations that came in Mecca focused on theology, focused on the hereafter and accountability. It was very existential and emphasized the importance of humans being aware of their choices and their actions, because, you know, it's all going to come back to you, whether in this life or the next. And later, things like the five daily prayers and the prohibition of alcohol came down. I mean, this is really fascinating when you think about it, you know, that the first decade of the early Muslims, they didn't pray five times a day, right? The focus was heavily social activism, fighting oppression, protecting the weak, removing, you know, constructs of racism and sexism and so on and so forth. And then prayer comes after. And this makes a lot of sense, because if I fall in love with a woman, okay, I'm not expected necessarily to fulfill all of her needs or expectations or prescriptions unless there is a formal contract with that person, i.e. marriage. So the early Muslims were focused on building spirituality and this connection with the divine. And once that was established, prayer was revealed to anchor them in their relationship to the divine. Because praying five times a day is not a chore, like doing the laundry, it's just another thing I need to get done, but it's actually a time where you get to step into a divine conversation. You get to have intimacy and contact with your Creator. And if you don't do this, then you feel this kind of long-distance relationship, and your heart's just not in it. You see how it all ties together? And so similarly, just like anybody out there who's married or has a, you know, a bonded relationship with even a parent or a brother or a cousin or whatever, if you don't ask about that person for years or ever call them or text them, then that person's going to question the nature of your relationship with them. Like, do they really love me? Do they care? So what about when we claim we love God and we've taken the shahada, which is our contract that binds us to this commitment, and then we no longer, we don't even bother connecting with the one we were supposed to have this intimate, loving relationship with. So tasawwuf really tries to build this reality and help each person experience this through the methods and systems that have been traditionally sourced. Now, how did that all kind of come together? Well, as Islam spread and left Arabia, it went to places first like Persia and Syria and Egypt. And in these places, they already had, you know, obviously rich history. They had existing power structures, religious traditions. And, you know, the early Muslims, when they left Arabia and went to these countries, they didn't like show up with a bunch of books on fiqh and aqidah and hadith. And they passed out pamphlets to all the locals, right? That's not what happened. They came and they exemplified the teachings and taught through words. And over the centuries, all of this knowledge that they brought with them became systematized and categorized into the subject matters of Islamic sciences. Hence, the madhahib, or the schools of sacred law, were formulated. Schools of theology and aqidah were formulated. Hadiths began to become collected into works. And of course, spirituality, or the inner sciences of psychology and spirituality, became systematized through the tariqah. Now, this is the case with every religion when it spread out of its local region to other lands. In order to perpetuate and preserve the teachings, they needed to systematize the subject matters of the religion. And Islam is no different. And tasawwuf is one of those sciences. And when you research traditional tasawwuf, all of these pathways trace back to the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of them go back to Ali ibn Abi Talib, with exception to one, which goes back to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So again, I encourage you to research more about this and learn about it, and pay attention to the themes in the Quran when it talks about the self and love and connection to God. Again, this is rooted in our tradition. It's not just some, you know, made up new agey stuff. Now, of course, there are, you know, what you may call deviant groups out there that claim to be Sufis, or are extreme even in their tasawwuf, just like you have extremism in orthodoxy and militant Islam and so on and so forth. So it's like any other tradition. It's going to have a spectrum of interpretation, practice, and application in different cultures and societies, but that shouldn't turn us away, because we could argue the same thing about the religion of Islam as a whole, right? Where there's a lot of people out there that take it and use it for their own agenda, and essentially any religion or any framework of thought or philosophy is going to be expressed through and by the people that attempt to practice it or embody it and interpret it. So it always comes down to one's psychology, one's intentions, and one's interpretations. Hence why Sufism is so crucial to healthy Islamic flourishing, because if we don't have the heart of Islam or the heart of the matter in a body, then the body does not have any blood. It doesn't have any passion. It doesn't have any love. It doesn't have any warmth. And perhaps that's one of the reasons why some of us feel like our heart isn't really in our religious practice. That's our show for today. Thank you for listening. Please subscribe and share with your friends, and I look forward to having a cup of coffee with you next time. Enjoy. La